Juan Pablo Escobar, welcome to Scandinavia.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here.
Your name these days is Sebastian Marroquin.
Yes.
Is that because the Escobar name is too much to carry?
It is because the airlines didn't wanted to sell any plane tickets to travel and to get away from violence, you know. We stayed in Colombia for a year waiting for somebody to help us.
After your father died?
After my father's death. And we asked the Vatican, the United Nations, and nobody wanted to help us. So it was our last option if we wanted to stay alive.
So that was when you could leave the country with your mother and your family?
The next day we changed our names. We could fly without any problems.
We saw some pictures of your father. And if you were to estimate, how many murders is he directly or indirectly responsible for?
Well, there is not an official record of that, but I believe that it is almost about 3,000 people.
And yet, to you, he is a very different person. He is your father, and you knew him as a very different person, and
well,
not a murderer.
I know both. I know both because he was my father, but also he was a bandit. And when I was 7 years old, he told me, look, I am a bandit. That's what I do for a living.
Before this, before you really knew, what kind of father was he?
Well, he was...
as far back as you can remember.
Well, I remember him giving me a lot of love, being at home with me and my family. He was a very good man with me. I received a lot of love from him. That's what I remember. I also remember when we went to see the poor villages in Colombia to help them. And that's the father that I knew at the beginning. But of course, he's now more remembered thanks to his violence, not for his good behavior at the beginning.
You describe him also as a vain person.
Well, yes, he really took care of his own hair and he stayed in front of the mirror for too many hours just to watch his teeth. So it took like 2 hours for him.
And to get ready in the morning, you know.
Yeah, and I asked him, what did it take you so long? And he told me, oh, you can go to the dentist. I can't.
You call him a bad loser, too.
Well, he didn't want to lose. He was always cheating, even to me or to my mom, to everybody. He didn't want to lose at all. When he played soccer, the game only ends when he was winning. And that's it.
And what if you played a board game or you had some woody cheats?
Well, used to play Monopoly. And yes, he hide all the money and everything. And even if he lose a lot, he was always winning. And I didn't know why, but he was making a lot of... he was cheating a lot, yeah.
Growing up as you did, as the son of one of the world's richest men, according to the Forbes list, at least.
Well, I didn't saw anybody from Forbes in our family looking into our wallets. It's a way to sell a lot of magazines.
But still, he was a very rich man.
He was a very rich man, and I asked him, how much money do you have? And he told me, I don't know. I really don't want to count that.
How could you notice that he was rich? I mean, were you a spoiled child, or did he not show?
Of course, I receive a lot of presents from him. I have more than 30 motorcycles, and we have our own zoo, private zoo.
You have how many motorcycles?
Sorry. More than 30.
More than 30 motorcycles?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a spoiled child, if I ever...
Yeah, but he gave me a lot of love and education, and he always was very near me at the time when he
you had this famous mansion called Hacienda Napolis.
Yes.
And this was really a big estate, a big property.
Yeah, we have our own airport and also more than 10 houses, more than 100 vehicles for us and for the guests. And if you didn't find anything inside the hacienda, you just could ask the chopper to go and buy that. So.
And you had a zoo as well.
Yes, a zoo and. And a lot of things, more than 1,000 animals from all over the world. We have hippos, giraffes, zebras,
live
elephants.
Animals.
Yes.
So how did he get them? How I mean, this is.
Well, he just sent a lot of people around the world to buy them, and I also went with him to some zoos inside the United States to buy some other animals. He paid $2 million for the elephants.
You were, I mean, you were also the son of a politician, not only a drug dealer, but a politician as well. I mean, Pablo Escobar was an ambitious politician.
Well, yes.
And he got far, but at some point, it was like the political establishment in Colombia realized who he was, what he did. And rejected him.
Well, my father felt.
How did he respond to that?
Well, my father felt humiliated, and the first answer was he resigned publicly, and after that he ordered the killing of the Minister of Justice, and that was in the year 1984, exactly. So, and after that, all the war began from the drug trafficking business against Colombia as a country, as their government, the authorities, everything. Was chaos.
So from that day on, it really became, it really changed.
Yeah, it really changed Colombia's life, our family's life, everybody's life.
And you were mostly on the run.
Since then.
From like everybody.
Yes, like I felt like I was a bandit because everybody was chasing, also me. I saw the reward signs asking for me.
Why did they chase you?
Well, at the time, the police in Colombia didn't recognize us as individuals. They thought we were the same man.
They went after his family as well.
After everybody, yeah.
How did you react to this? Did you talk to your father about this? Did you try to change him?
Of course, I did that a lot of times when
you were a teenager here.
Yes, mostly when I was 11 years old, in 1988, there was a car bomb. Exploded in Medellin, January 13, against our home. It was thanks to the Cali cartel, that bomb.
What kind of car bomb?
700 kilos of dynamite who smashed all the glasses around 1 kilometer around the city. Everything was... I remember the newspaper, they called that Medellin woke up as Beirut.
But how did you survive that, if it was meant for you?
It is a miracle. I have the pictures, and I don't know, I can't understand how...
What happened? Did you wake up and...
Well, what's the last part you see when you're going to sleep? The ceiling, no? When I get up, I saw the sky. There was nothing left. But we were there.
Do you remember the conversations you had with your father where you tried to reach him, to change him?
Of course. Well... When I saw the bombs in the news, I told him, look, what's going on? You don't have to do this. You should not do this. A lot of innocent people is dying. And he answered me, look, I didn't invent this. They used this against my family, my beloved ones. And I answered to him, if anybody puts me a bomb, that doesn't allow me to put bombs to everybody. I don't believe in violence. And that's why he approached the government and tried to, you know, when he surrendered to La Catedral prison, it was a way of showing the family a little bit of respect. So he wanted to make peace. He wanted to end violence in Colombia. And he surrendered. And my mother was doing the same thing, was just challenging him. And asking him why didn't he stop violence.
Did he, how did he react when you challenged him?
Well, he was very respectful, I may say, but...
He wasn't aggressive or...
Yeah, he was open to the conversation, but he wasn't willing to change anything. You know, the CIA was after him, the FBI, everybody was after him, and nobody could stop him. Neither do I as a 14-year-old kid.
He volunteered for prison, as you mentioned.
Yeah.
A prison that he got to build himself.
Well, he's the first bandit in human history that really and actually built his own prison.
Yeah.
And he changed
quite
Colombia.
Comfortable as well.
Very comfortable.
And
yeah.
Then he ran away again.
Yeah, when the government ordered to translate him to another place, he get out of the prison. He was the owner of the prison.
He was the greatest producer of narcotics in the world at some point.
Well, he's accused of being the owner of the 80% of the market in the 80s.
Cocaine, yeah.
Cocaine.
Do you have any memories of the drugs in your family? Did anyone in your family use drugs, as you remember?
Well, I have an uncle who died because of drug abuse. And we are very aware of that. And when I was 8 years old, my father talked to me about drugs. He put all the drugs in front of me, and he teach me how to recognize every one of them. He told me what happened if I abuse of every kind of them. And he told me, if you ever want to try, you come and we will try it together. After that, I felt that there was a legalization for me. So I didn't felt curious and I never tried.
So you never tried?
No, until I was 28 years old, I tried marijuana and that's it.
Did he try himself? Do you think he used it?
Yeah, he told me that he tried all of them, but not heroin. And he told me that he always liked marijuana, but nothing more. He teach me that cocaine was a poison to sell and not to take.
When you were 16, your father died.
Yes.
And you were the last person to talk to him. He called you up. Why do you think he called you?
Because he wanted to be found. It was a way of committing suicide. Because my father
because
knew...
the family, you were in hiding... No, you were in hiding in an apartment, right?
Well, we tried to get out of the country.
Yeah.
We flew to Germany. And the authorities there, they make us, against our will, they make us return to Colombia. And after that, my father understood that there was will be never any safe place for his family. And he understood that either we are going to appear as dead or he had to choose that. That's why he started calling. He has his bodyguard near to him. He always teach me not to use the telephone because it was death. As his own words, don't use telephone because it's death. That's why he start calling more than 7 times. And I'm start protecting him. I just hang up the phone.
Because you both
knew
it was tapped.
Of course, and we were forced to check in into a hotel who was owned by the Colombian Army Forces. So it was very clear that everything was tapped. That we have microphones all over the place, and he was the most wanted man in the world. And he really knew how to get out of the authorities very easily. And that's why it was so hard for me to knowing him that he was calling just to be traced and to be killed.
So what was this last conversation about?
Well, we were talking about an interview from a very well-known magazine in Colombia. He wanted to give me the answers, and I was explaining to him, I know all the answers. We spoke a lot. You don't have to stay in the phone because you know what's going to happen. And I hang up, but he was kept calling and calling and calling, and that's why I understood that he was willing to get killed.
You... As you know, the official version of what happened is that Pablo Escobar was shot by the police while trying to escape.
Well, we have more than one official version. If you ask the North Americans, they will tell you we were the ones who killed Pablo Escobar. And if you ask the Colombian police, they will tell you we were the ones.
And so you have your own opinion about this?
I don't have opinion. I have proofs. I have evidence. It's different from opinions.
How come?
Because I have the recordings of my father. He never talked too much in the telephone. So that's the first proof.
He had taught you how to commit suicide?
Yes, because we didn't want it to be tortured by the police. We preferred to be
dead. And
this
is why you think that he committed suicide himself?
And he taught me because he told me not to fire in his mouth or any other part, just in the right ear. And it was the same place where the bullet appeared.
What have you learned yourself?
Well, I learned so much about violence that I became a man of peace, you know, because I don't believe in violence. I know how it can, you know, disappear a country, a whole country. It can change culture, it can change people. Money doesn't buy you happiness or freedom. Even worse, my father's money, at the end, it was for the financing his own death, you know. So it was, we were dying.
In what sense do you mean financing his own death?
Because when my father died, the cartels approached to us and they told us, we are going to recover all the money that we spent killing your father for these last 10 years. So we're going to take everything if you want to stay alive. Say, thank you. Take everything you I have. I just want to live. I don't want anything.
After your father's death, were you seriously threatened? Did you feel like you were threatened? Your life?
Well, my head worth $4 million. I have to explain that nobody else is paying that mad money now. So nobody don't get very happy about that because...
So that was the price of your head?
Yeah, that was the price, $4 million. Just for being the son of Pablo Escobar.
Was that because people were afraid, his enemies were afraid that you would revenge him?
Yeah, they were very afraid of that.
Juan Pablo, today you live in Argentina.
Yes.
You escaped from Colombia after your father's death. You live in Argentina. You're an architect, I know.
Yes, also an industrial designer.
And you have a wife and kid.
4-year-old kid, yes.
And your mother, she's also there. Why don't you return to Colombia now? It's been so many years.
Well, I have to wait until 14 years since my father's death to say goodbye to him because of the threats, you know. Everybody was telling me, if you ever came back, we will kill you. So I had to stay in Argentina. I don't have... the option of returning to Colombia. That's not an option for me.
Thank you so much for sharing your story with us tonight.
Thanks to you.
Juan Pablo, thank you so much.